and get started. Good evening, and thank you so much for being with us tonight on Facebook, and we're also on YouTube, also YouTube Live. So if Facebook's not working or something, you can go to YouTube and find us there also. So just letting you know that. But let's be in prayer for tonight's service. Let's be in prayer for what the Lord has put on Pastor Mike's heart. And we're going to worship together, but first, let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll get started. Lord, we just want to love you and thank you for everything you've given us. Lord, we ask you just to be with us tonight. Be with us as we worship and play through these songs. And Lord, maybe just see the words of these songs, Lord, and truly take it to heart. And Lord, thank you, Lord, just for your amazing grace that you've shown for us and sending your Son down to die on the cross for us. Lord, we love you. Again, be with us tonight, Lord. And as this tough time continues, Lord, we just ask you to be with each and every one that is that's watching tonight, Lord, and be with their hearts, Lord, how heavy they are, Lord. And we ask you just to give them comfort and give them joy during this tough time. But Lord, we love you and thank you. And stick into the word together tonight and help us worship. In your name I pray. Amen. All right, we're going to sing Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. So sing with me. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me, His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion me as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine. we thank you. Be with us tonight. Be with Brother Mike. Give him the words to say. And I pray. Amen. Brother Mike.
Amen. Good evening, and welcome to everyone that's watching live stream. Appreciate you being in church with us tonight, and appreciate Trey coming and leading us in song. I appreciate Brian and Donna for all they do for the live streaming, and Eric. And we, again, don't know how long this will last, but it soon will be over, and as many have texted, we cannot wait to get back with our church family. And I just believe it's going to be a wonderful first Sunday back, don't you? So keep praying. Keep encouraging one another. Keep giving. As I said the last time, our financial obligations, they don't take a break when the rest of the world takes a break. And I so appreciate you who give faithfully. And I want to encourage you, if you don't give, trust the Lord and step out on faith and believe in his word, and I know he'll bless you. Look with me in Revelation chapter number 1. Revelation chapter number 1. I'd like to begin reading in verse number 9. I'll give you just a moment for those that are at the house or wherever to look for the scripture. Verse 9, I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation and in the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet, saying, I am the Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, and what thou seest, write in a book, and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus, unto Smyrna, unto Pergamos, and unto Thyatira, unto Sardis, Philadelphia, and unto Laodicea. And I turned to see the voice that spake with me, and being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. And in the midst of seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girt about the paps with a golden girdle. His head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire. And his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. And he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun that shineth in his strength. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. And he laid his right hand upon me, saying unto me, Fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of hell and death. Write these things which thou hast seen, and the things which are, and the things which shall be hereafter. The mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. Heavenly Father, we thank you for allowing us to be in the house of the Lord this evening. I'm thankful for all those that are watching live stream. Heavenly Father, I'm just thankful to be here. I'm thankful to have the health to come tonight and to speak. Many things are on our heart. The sick of our church, we have so many that are sick in our church, and we lift them up to you in prayer. Heavenly Father, our nation is in dire need of prayer. We need a touch from God, and I pray so. This virus, I pray, Heavenly Father, it would soon to end. But Heavenly Father, I'm reminded that through the days of adversity, you always get glory and honor out of so many things. So I know that everything works after the counsel of your own will. So we'll continue to pray and we'll be patient. But it's during this time that our church, Heavenly Father, may we be the hands and feet of Jesus. May we truly help those who are in need and befriend those who need a friend. And as I said in the beginning, Heavenly Father, that first Sunday that we are back, I'm expecting a wonderful move of God. I am, and I'm expecting that. So, Heavenly Father, just be with us tonight. You've laid this sermon on my heart, and I hope it will be an encouragement to all those who are listening. And now speak through me, your Spirit speaking through me. And these words will bring glory and honor unto the name of the Son of God, Jesus Christ. That's my prayer. Amen and amen. The word revelation means an unveiling, or it means a revealing. And really, when you read all the chapters, it is the revealing of Jesus Christ, especially when he returns in Revelation 19. And the great thing about it, we get to come with him, the church. Now, that's going to be one more day. When Christ returns to the earth, he sets up his millennial kingdom, and all the armies of heaven follow him. And those armies are arrayed in fine linen, white and clean. That army is the church. What a day that'll be. But here, John, he finds himself exiled on the Isle of Patmos. He's there for great persecution. I say this all the time. The devil sent him to the Isle of Patmos to shut him up, and God sent him out there on a mission, because it was there he received these wonderful words from Jesus Christ concerning the book of Revelation. He said in verse 9, he said, John, I'm also your brother and companion in tribulation and in the kingdom of patience of Jesus Christ. I was in the isle called Patmos for the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and he heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet, saying that I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. And what thou seest, you're to write in a book and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus and unto Smyrna, unto Pergamos, unto Thyatira, Sardis, and unto Philadelphia and unto Laodicea. So right off the bat, John was commissioned by God, write this and send it to the seven churches which are in Asia Minor. They were really churches then. I like to think of it, though, as seven being the complete number of God. And those seven churches, even individual churches in those days of John, to me gives the picture of the true complete church. And when we read these letters to these churches, they're similar structure, their similar nature. In other words, he addresses one particular congregation. Second of all, the letter introduces to them Jesus. Third, a statement regarding the condition of the church is given. Four, there's a verdict from Jesus regarding the condition of the church. Five, a command from Jesus to the church. Six, a general exhortation to all Christians. And lastly, there is a promise given of a reward. So first of all, he mentions Ephesus. And when you read that small part about Ephesus, they were doctrinally sound, but they had forsaken their first love. In the book of Acts, Ephesus had this great revival that went on. I mean, the whole town was turned upside down. And yet 40 to 50 years later, here's John on the Isle of Patmos writing back to them, and they were doctrinally sound, but yet the Lord said they had left their first love. Smyrna was told that she would suffer great persecution. Jesus said in Revelation 2:9, I know thy works in tribulation and poverty, but you're rich. And I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are of the synagogue of Satan. For none of these things which thou shalt suffer, behold, the devil will even cast some of you into prison that they may be tried, and you shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I'll give thee the crown of life. So Smyrna was a church that the Lord said would be persecuted greatly. Now, the next church that John mentions is the church of Pergamos. It was a church that just flat out needed to repent it for false doctrine. He said in Revelation 2 and 13, I know thy works where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is, and thou holdest fast my name, and hast not denied my faith, even in those days where Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you where Satan dwelleth. But I have a few things against thee, because that hast there them to hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornication. Jesus told them, repent, or else I'll come quickly, and I'll fight against them with the sword of my mouth. So yeah, Pergamos, they had allowed false doctrine to creep in. Jesus said, you need to repent. Thyatira had a false prophetess. She was the smallest and least importance of the seven cities in history, and really we don't have any record that Christians really suffered anything in Thyatira. But Jesus said, I know your works and charity and service and faith and patience and thy works, and to the last you're to be more than the first. But notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication and to eat things offered unto idols. Next church was Sardis. The problem with Sardis, they had fallen asleep. And to the angel of the church in Sardis write, these things saith he that hath the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before God. There's a lot of Sardises today. They have a name on the outside that they are a church. They have a name on the outside that says, come in and worship with us. But inside they're as dead can be, and nothing goes on at all for God's glory and honor. He told them, watchful and strengthen, I have not found thy works perfect. He talked to Philadelphia. And Philadelphia was the faithful church, and they had endured patiently. Okay, they had endured patiently and patiently. He said, these things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth, and shutteth and no man openeth. I know thy works, and behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it, for thou hast little strength, and you have kept my word, and hast not denied my name. And then the last letter goes to a church named Laodicea. They were known as the lukewarm church. I know thy works, you're neither cold nor hot. I would that thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold or hot, I'll spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest that I'm rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. Jesus said, I counsel thee to buy me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, in white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness doth not appear, and anoint thy eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. And as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. So John was commissioned to write these seven letters to the messengers of the seven churches. And you'll see that they were particular congregations. They were introduced to Jesus. They had a statement of their condition. Jesus gave them a verdict. Jesus commanded them to the church. And then a general exhortation to all Christians. Now, I read all that, and I thought all of a sudden this. What if the Lord sent New Hope Baptist Church a letter? Now, some of you are laughing at home. I can see you. No, I can't see you. What if he sent us a letter? What if he sent us a letter like he did to the seven churches in the book of Revelation? What if he started out like this? Unto the angel of the church of New Hope Baptist Church, write these things, saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. What would he say to us? What would he condemn among us here at the church? Would he have any words of praise? Now, I thought a lot about that. I think he would have some words of praise. I really do. When we meet here at our church, we can really feel the Spirit of God move, and I know where God moves, he's welcomed. So I think he would commend us for that. that we really welcome in the Spirit of God, that we really come hungry to feel the Lord Jesus Christ, and we're seeing Him move and work in our congregation, and people are getting saved. So I believe, yes, I believe He would be pleased with that. I believe He would be pleased with our missions. And all of you know that we give 20% of our income or our tithes and offerings go right back out into the mission field. I believe that the Lord would be pleased with that. I believe He would be pleased with the way that we took care of one another and we carried one another's burdens. I believe He would be pleased with the way that we try to reach out into the community and make sure they have the gospel, make sure that they have clothing, making sure they have food and their needs met. I believe all those things, I believe with all my heart that Jesus would be pleased with that. But then it'd be some things that He would challenge us with. And He'd always remind us, and these are some things that came to my heart. The first thing that I believe that Jesus in His letter, after commending us as He did certain churches in here, I believe He would say right off the bat, New Hope Baptist Church, always remember to be true to the Word of God. Always remember, because we're living in a day in which men, pastors, are tempted to water down the Word of God to appease the crowds. And Jesus knows that. I believe that letter would come straight to us, and you remain and you continue preaching the Word of God. You remember what Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy 4 in verse 2. Preach the word, be instant in season and out of season, reprove, rebuke, and exhort with all long suffering and doctrine. I believe He would remind us of what Paul told Timothy in chapter 3, verse 16 of 2 Timothy. Timothy, all scripture is given by the inspiration of God. It is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good work. I believe in that letter, He would remind us to stay true to the Word of God, because we live in a day that men can so easily be tempted, churches can be so easily tempted to lay aside the hard things of God's Word to appease the hearts of men. I believe He would remind us of that. I'll tell you something else I believe He would remind us of. I believe He would say, New Hope Baptist Church, be cautious of forgetting the Lord. And I believe He would take us back to the book of Deuteronomy when the children of Israel made their way from the land of Egypt into bondage, going into the promised land. And the Bible says in Deuteronomy 8 and 7, "For the Lord thy God bringeth thee into a good land, a land of brooks of water, of fountains and depths that spring out of the valleys and the hills, a land of wheat and barley and vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive and honey, a land wherein thou shalt eat bread without scarceness. Thou shalt not lack anything in it. A land whose stones are iron, and out of whose hills thou mayest dig brass. But when thou hast eaten and art full, then thou shalt bless the Lord thy God for the good land which He hath given thee. But beware that thou forget not the Lord thy God in not keeping His commandments and His judgments and His statutes which I commanded thee this day, lest when thou hast eaten and art full and hast built goodly houses and dwell therein, when thy herds and thy flocks multiply and thy silver and thy gold is multiplied and all that thou hast is multiplied, then thine heart be lifted up and thou forget the Lord thy God, which brought thee forth out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage." I believe the Lord would tell us that in His letter. I believe He would say, "Do what you stay true to the Word of God." And then I believe He would tell us right off the bat, "Do not forget me." Because you and I are all for prone to forget God when everything's going great. That's it. Amen. I believe I can say that with all my heart. When everything is going fine, we have a tendency to slip. We have a tendency to slack up on our faithfulness because there's really no pressing need right now that we really need to be in contact with the Lord. But as we know today, let adversity strike and it gets our attention. I believe in the letter He would say, "Do not forget me. Do not get full. Do not get your goodly houses and all your wealth and all your gold. And do not forget me," if you're in that position today. Many people have. Many people have forgotten the Lord. I'll tell you something else I believe he would put in the letter. I believe he would say, New Hope Baptist Church, be cautious of the Laodicean church, the Laodicean spirit. You see, because they said, I'm rich and increased with goods, and we don't have need of nothing. And Jesus said, knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. He told him, he said, I know your works, you're neither cold nor hot. Now they understood that terminology in Laodicea because their water source came from two places. It came, one, from a hot springs, two, it came from a cold spring. And they met, and by the time it got into Laodicea, it was just simply dirty, tepid water, which usually could not even be drank but spat out. They knew the terminology of what Jesus was saying. You are lukewarm. That was their assessment of the church. So then, because you are lukewarm, I'll spew thee out of my mouth. New Hope Baptist Church, may we never become lukewarm. May we never say as what they said, we're rich and we're increased with goods and we don't have need of nothing. May we never get to that point at New Hope Baptist Church where we think that we have arrived and we got everything that we need, because we too could become just like Laodicea, lukewarm in our spirit, and we know what God says about being lukewarm. I believe he would put that in the letter to our church. New Hope, stay true to the Word of God. And we have so far, haven't we? And thank God for that. But there might come a day when men are tempted not to. No, let's stay true to the Word of God. A New Hope, let's be cautious of forgetting the Lord. Let's be cautious of the Laodicean spirit. Fourthly, he gave me something else in the letter. I believe he would say to New Hope, be cautious of spiritual dehydration. How did they become lukewarm? How did they get themselves in that kind of shape? They were spiritually what? Dehydrated. They had no thirst for God, no hunger for his presence, and no hunger for his word. The psalmist said in 42:1, as the hart panteth after the water brook, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. My soul thirsteth for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? And my tears have been my meat day and night, while they continually say unto me, where is thy God? And he said, when I remember these things, I pour out my soul in me, for I had gone with the multitude, and I went with them to the house of God with a voice of joy and praise, and with the multitude that keep the holy day. I believe he would tell us, be cautious of being spiritually dehydrated, because we have no thirst for God. We have no hunger for God. There was a little preacher out in Los Angeles, California. He writes this: I've come to the conclusion that losing your hunger and thirst for God will take you to being lukewarm, indifferent, and finally to a spiritual death. This is one of the saddest conditions for a Christian, to fall into lukewarm spirituality. We come to the point where spiritual things lose their value, shine, and importance. We lose the desire to read and pray and spend time alone with God. For this reason, we must never allow anything to diminish our deep desire for the things of God. He said, in our lives, in my journey as a believer, I've seen certain things that can take a person to diminish and to lose all of his hunger and thirst for God. These things could completely remove the desire to experience his glory in a fresh and new way. He said, one thing that I have desired of the Lord, that I'll seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. Psalms 27:4. Whatever it takes, we must determine ourselves to spend time with God. It's in these times that God will give us greater hunger and thirst for his presence. Psalm 63:1 said, the Psalm of David, when he was in the wilderness of Judah, O my God, thou art my God, early will I seek thee, and my soul thirsteth for thee. My flesh longeth for thee in a dry and thirsty land where no water is. Let's be cautious that we don't become spiritually hydrated, because if we do, then we will be like the church of Laodicea. We will become lukewarm. And then it reminds me of something else. Because we have a tendency to become lukewarm, we become spiritually dehydrated, I believe he would put in the letter for us, be cautious of mechanical worship. New Hope, may we never become mechanical in our worship. May we never come in at 10:45 knowing we're going to get out at 12 every day. Amen. May we never come in and watch our watches and know exactly. May we never put anything in a program that tells everybody what we're going to do in our worship service. No, it's God's service, and we're here to worship Him. And may we never become mechanical in that, where we just come in and we go out, and we come in and we go out, and we act the same way, and nothing ever happens. I believe he would put in that letter, guys, do not become mechanical in your worship. I believe it was Vance Havner that said this, I'm sick to death of the so-called Christianity of our day. What's supernatural about it? When do people come out of the sanctuary awed and can't speak for an hour because God has been in glory there? No, he said, as soon as they get out, they're talking football or sports or something, or there's something going to be a big sale downtown somewhere here. We're not even caught up into eternity. When did the last time you tiptoe out of the sanctuary and you couldn't say a word to anybody because you were so overwhelmed with the glory of God? End of quote. That was a true statement. Mechanical. We can turn it on, turn it off, can't we? We can turn it off in our singing and turn it on in our singing. We can turn it off in our praise and quickly turn it off. I believe he would tell us, New Hope Baptist Church, when you come here, you do as the psalmist said, you enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise, and be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good and his mercy is everlasting and his truth endureth to all generations. Amen for that. May every time we come, we enter into his courts with our hearts ready. We are already prepared before we get here, and we're ready to worship. I want to tell you something else I believe he would put in our letter. New Hope Baptist Church, be cautious of never expecting anything great from the Lord. How often do we come and we don't expect nothing? I believe he would put that in there. Church, be cautious of never expecting anything great from the Lord. Be cautious of not expecting a great move of his spirit or salvation among my people. There's churches that hadn't seen anybody saved in 5, 6, or 7 years. There's churches right now that have dirt in their baptistry. It hadn't had any water in it in a while. I'll tell you right now, as a pastor of New Hope, I'm thankful for what we have here. Amen? I am. Let us never, never come not expecting something great from God. Let us never not one time enter into this door and wonder, will he or will he not save somebody? Will somebody be healed? Will somebody have their heart healed from broken heart? May we come in expecting God to do greater things than we could ever imagine. Because if we don't, we become complacent. This is a place we go. Something else he put on my heart. And for those of you that's counting, we're up to number 7. I only have 9, so hang with me. He said, Mike, be cautious of the little sin that can so easily lead you down the path to destruction and also hinder your prayers. I thought about the Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 15. Take us, the foxes, the little foxes, that spoil the vines, for our vines have tender grapes. It's just the small little foxes that can destroy the grapevines. And it's that little sin in our hearts that can so easily lead us down to the path of destruction. And it's also, it's that little sin in our heart that can hinder our prayer life. How many times have you heard me repeat Psalm 66 and 18, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. I don't know about you, but I want to make sure my line is clean between me and the Father. Any little sin in your heart tonight, any sin of unforgiveness, any sin of bitterness, hatred, malice, you name it, if you have that in your heart tonight and you've not dealt with it with God, I'm going to tell you based upon the Word of God, your prayers don't go nowhere. He said, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. That could be a place for all of us tonight to search our hearts and get quiet with the Lord and say, Lord, reveal to me if I have any of those little sins in my heart. I want rid of them. I want to have power in prayer. That's what he would tell us. The eighth thing I believe he would put in his letter, be fearful of losing our vision of hell. One preacher said it best, the only vision many of you have is television. That was pretty good. And that got my toes too. Okay. He said, do you know what's wrong with the modern day preaching? It's missing three things. One, it has no intensity. Two, it has no majesty. Three, it has no eternity. He said, I'm convinced that the greatest thing about those Puritan preachers is that they lived in eternity 6 days a week and came down to earth on the seventh. Our preachers today are golfing on Saturday and goofing around the other 5 days. It's a profession to most of them when it should be an obsession with them. That goes to me. May I never lose my vision of hell. May this church never lose her vision of hell. So what have we learned so far in our letter? I believe the Lord would say, be true to God's word. Be cautious of forgetting the Lord. Be cautious of having this Laodicean spirit. Be cautious of spiritual dehydration. Be cautious of mechanical worship. Be cautious of never expecting anything great from the Lord. And be cautious that we don't lose our vision of hell. And lastly, I think he would put into the letter, church, get back to the basics of why we are here. Jesus said in Matthew 4:19, he saith unto them, follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. Paul said in First Corinthians 3, beginning in verse 7, neither he that is planteth anything, neither he that watereth, but God that giveth the increase. Now he that planteth and he that watereth are one, and every man shall receive his own reward according to his labor. For we are laborers together with God, you're God's husbandry, you're God's building. Back to the basics, New Hope. What is it? If we're following Jesus, we're fishermen of men. If everybody here became a true fisher of men and planted that seed, how much glory and honor could be brought to the Lord? I believe he would put that in his letter to New Hope Baptist Church. Charles Spurgeon said this, and I quote, if the fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much in the eyes of God, then which prayer would gather the greatest harvest, a 5-minute prayer or 5 hours of prayer? Well, that stuck with me. It showed me the ineptness of my prayer life, the deficiency in my prayer life. When I read that, it showed me my deficiency in prayer. Yes, if the fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much in the eyes of God, then which prayer should gather the greatest harvest, a 5-minute prayer or 5 hours of prayer? New Hope Baptist Church, let's stay true to the Word of God. Let's be cautious of forgetting the Lord. Let's be cautious of that Laodicean spirit where we're neither hot nor cold. And because of that, we become spiritually dehydrated. And because of that, we become mechanically worship. We go through the motions without really any substance. And then when we get to that point, we really don't expect anything great from the Lord. And then our little sins don't bother us. And then we lose our vision of hell. Is that not right? That's pretty well the digression down when we become weak in spirit. So I challenge us, New Hope. Let's remain strong. Let's remain the church that we are. You guys are great. You guys are fabulous. But let's watch these things. Let's be cautious we don't let these things slip into our own lives. Let's be cautious. Heavenly Father, thank you for the Word of God. I thank you for the book of Revelation. I thank you for those 7 letters that you gave to those 7 churches in Asia Minor. You challenged them. You commended them. You condemned them. The same way you would with us. If you sent us a letter, there'd be some commendation. Yes, I'm pleased with this and I'm pleased with that, but Yeah, there might be some other words. I know thy works. You know our works here. You know our individual heart of works. You know tonight whether we're clean or not in your eyes. Everyone that's watching this sermon, you know their hearts. And you know if they're clean in the eyes of God. You know, Heavenly Father, you search our hearts. You know if there's bitterness there, if there's lust there. You know if there's malice and anger and hate. You know our hearts. And Heavenly Father, I pray that through the Holy Spirit that you would reveal those things to us tonight. And that we would be willing to bend a knee before God Almighty and say, Lord, clean my heart. Do what David did in Psalms 139. Clean me, Lord. I pray that for our church. I feel in my heart the best days of New Hope Baptist Church are still before us. And I'm expecting some great things, Heavenly Father, to happen when we all meet again. I really do. I'm expecting there's going to be a great move of God. I'm expecting there's going to be a greater influx of people coming to our church. People that are hungry to feel God. People that are hungry for the Word of God. And people that are hungry to display that love to a lost and dying world. I believe that's going to happen at our church. I'm expecting it. You are preparing us for that. So just may we be faithful. May we continue to do the things that I believe are pleasing unto you. And may we guard our heart from these eight things that you've given us tonight. Guard our hearts. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Church, before Trey comes and sings to close out our service, I want you to always remember to faithfully pray for all those that are sick in our church. You know who they are. You know their condition. Please lift them up to the Lord in prayer. Be fervent about it and pray for their comfort and pray for their healing. That's my prayer. I love you. And Lord's willing, I'll see you Sunday morning. Okay, Brother Trey.
Before I sing Jesus Messiah, and I know we all know this song, but one of the things that really hit me is to make sure, for me personally, just to make sure when I come up here, not to become mechanical each and every time we come up here and we sing. So tonight, if you're watching, sing this out wherever you are. And one of the main things that really hits me and what I absolutely love is to, when I see my children sing and see my children worship the Lord, and whether they know exactly what they're saying or not, you get to watch them. So kids, if you're watching tonight, I want to say sing it out from the bottom of your heart. And I know some of you guys, either the youth, if you're watching, and I know there's some children that love to sing, and so let's all lift this up to Him, Jesus Messiah.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become His righteousness. And He humbled Himself, and He carried the cross. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, a name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, and the ransom from heaven. Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. His body the bread, His blood the wine, the broken and poured out all for love. And the whole world trembled, and the veil was torn. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, the name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, and the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all our hope. All our hope is in you. All our hope is in you. All the glory to you, God, the light of the world, Jesus Messiah, the name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, and the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all, Jesus Messiah, the Lord of all.
Close out with a word of prayer. Lord, we love you and thank you. Be with us tonight. Lord, there's something here, Lord, in your message tonight. Lord, I pray, Lord, if it's touched at heart, let it continue to convict us. And Lord, what this time right now has shown me is to be cautious. Like Mike was saying, this message tonight was for me. To be cautious in each and every time we get up here. Let it not be mechanical. Let it be straight to you, Lord, with what we say and what we do. And Lord, for me, what this time has shown me, Lord, is what I need to fix at home. What this time has shown me is how much we need to make our home strong for you, for all the men and women who are over their households, and not to compromise. And it's so easy to bring our kids here to church and then let our teachers take a hold of it. But Lord, what we need to do right now is get our home strong. What we need right now, Lord, is to be cautious, because the devil is always lurking around, seeking who he may devour, Lord. So tonight, let us take an inventory of our lives. Let us strengthen our homes for you. Let us gather our kids around. Let us gather our families around and get into the Word together. Lord, we love you and thank you. Be with us again tonight. Be the rest of the week. Bring us back Sunday. Lord, it all be in your will. And I pray. Amen. Thank you.